One leg. Myers calls for a break from Roger Kirby, but Tyler can't get away. Kirby right on top of him, straining the end into the rope. Roger Kirby tossing the rule book aside. Tyler a bit the worst for wear right now. Kirby has an opening, and he tries to follow up with a hard kick to the head of Buzz Tyler. Roger Kirby, a very powerful individual. Another kick to the head. Kirby comes off the first rope for extra leverage, but still one more kick was delivered with the flat of the foot, so it's legal. Now Kirby using the ropes to work on the face of Buzz Tyler, and the referee chases Kirby away from those ropes. Tyler with a punch to his stomach. Buzz Tyler trying to come back against Roger Kirby. Kirby flails away. He lifts Tyler and loses it. Kirby falls underneath Buzz Tyler. Tyler shoved off by Kirby, and Kirby scoops out underneath the rope, buying a little extra time after losing his balance while trying a body slam.
3 minutes left. 3 minutes.
At the count of seven, Roger Kirby is back to the rope. Kirby was smart right there, a little bit of ring generalship by Roger. He was shaken. He took a hard jolt when he tried to body slam Tyler and ended up falling beneath those 324 pounds. So really, give Kirby a little credit. He was using his head by bailing out there and taking advantage of the count outside the ring. Kirby hits the rope. Oh, Tyler waiting with an elbow smash. Tyler covers Kirby, count of one. Not a real solid body press there by Tyler. He wasn't fully across him with his whole body weight. Knee lift by Tyler puts Kirby down. Tyler lifts Kirby. Kirby grabs the rope. Oh, and pulls Tyler right out of the ring with him and outside the ring to the floor. Kirby did not want to get caught by that power slam of Buzz Tyler. And now it's Kirby and Tyler outside the ring and on the floor. Kirby fighting back, trying to make his way back to the ring, but Tyler cuts him off. Slams Kirby's head into the ring step. Look out. Again, Tyler slamming Kirby into the second set of steps. And Roger Kirby definitely getting the worst of his Donnybrook outside the ring a third time. Kirby slammed into the steps. Kirby and Tyler had a toe-to-toe outside the ring, and the referee calling for the bell. Both been called out outside the ring, I'm sure. That means the bout will be ruled a draw. It's Tyler and Kirby toe-to-toe. And finally, Kirby trying to get back in. Sonny Myers having a tough time separating the two. But with the referee counting both men out outside the ring, the match is ruled a draw. We're going to make it official when Mickey Garagiola finds out whether or not it's safe to get into that ring. Sonny Myers trying to pull Tyler and Kirby apart. They're still at it outside the ring. The real brawl back out of Donnybrook between Tyler and Kirby. Sonny Myers trying to separate the two. Finally gets in between them, but again, Tyler comes back. Drops Kirby. Tyler and Kirby at it outside the ring. I think Sonny Myers finally has them separated. Let's go to the ring and hear from Mickey Garagiola.
Referee Sonny Myers counts both wrestlers outside the ring. This match is a draw. 2 minute time limit. Introducing from Samoa, weighing 235 pounds, Tapu. And from Reno, Nevada, weighing 250 pounds, the Missouri State Champion, Dick the Bruiser, referee at one.
Missouri State Champion, Dick the Bruiser, clashes with Tapu. Tapu hasn't been on Wrestling at the Chase for a few years. Native of Samoa, he's been coming on strong throughout the southern part of the Midwest. He gets a great opportunity here today against the one and only, the world's most dangerous wrestler, Dick the Bruiser. The Bruiser sees all that hair, and my goodness, I can't keep my hands out of it. With all that hair, I tell you, temptation might be just too much for Dick the Bruiser. Tapu should have gotten a Gene Kaminsky haircut before he went to the ring for this match.
He might have one when he leaves.
Good point. I notice that as soon as Dick the Bruiser gets near the ring, Mickey Garagiola is going up, patting him on the back, trying to be friends with him. You're not dumb, Mick. You're a smart boy. Get on his good side. Maybe he'll only wreck the table and the chair and not you, too.
You're so truly right about that, Larry. I tell you.
A test of strength between Tapu and Dick the Bruiser. Tapu showing some power right there, but the Bruiser comes up on top of it, reaches inside and flings Tapu over without using the hair. And the Bruiser says, what do you think of that? Yes, indeed, it was a shock. He did not pull the hair. The Bruiser rakes his boot across the forehead of Tapu, does it a second time. The Bruiser just keeps looking at that hair. It's only a matter of time. It's like putting chocolate chip cookies in front of a two-year-old baby. No way. No way. Tapu grabs the Bruiser by the throat. Ed Warren, the referee, cautions Tapu to let him out of the corner. Tapu right back strangling Dick the Bruiser. Want to try it again, says the Bruiser. And I think Tapu is a bit unnerved. The Bruiser's in that air there. And Tapu's head is driven face first into the top turnbuckle. The Bruiser grabs Tapu by the hair a second time. And the Bruiser goes on the warpath against Tapu. Wouldn't he love to do that to Harley Race when the Missouri title's on the line in a best of three balls battle? Two old and bitter rivals, Dick the Bruiser and Harley Race, and the Missouri State Championship on the line. It's going to be just this kind of battle when they go at it nose to nose. The Bruiser with a smash spins Tapu. The Bruiser grabs Tapu right by the windpipe. And then a hard forearm smash into the chest. This one's for you, Mick, says the Bruiser. I don't know if he means he's going to give you Tapu or if he is going to punch Tapu.
I'm glad that Tapu is the DH of this wrestling bout, I'll tell you that.
The designated hitter. That makes the Bruiser the designated hitty. He's the hitter.
Right.
Tapu's the hitty, right?
Right.
Tapu outside the ring and referee Ed Warren trying to keep the Bruiser back. Let him in the ring, says Ed Warren. But the Bruiser, he sends blood. He's right on top of Tapu and slams him into that buckle. The Bruiser bouncing all over that ring, and Ed Warren just can't seem to corral the Bruiser. How many have been able to? Harley Race hopes he's the one that can, and the race can begin his fourth reign as the Missouri State Champion. By virtue of a victory over the Bruiser, the man who put Race out of action with a pile driver on the cement floor. And Race has never forgotten that. Tapu with a chop, a couple of chops to the head of the Bruiser. He's trying to strangle the Bruiser. That's easier said than done. Look at the Bruiser's neck. The neck is part of the shoulders. To strangle someone with a build like the Bruiser is very difficult to do unless the man trying to do it is so powerful himself. The Bruiser is flexing those muscles. That one finally got in there. He was able to reach inside all that muscle and bulk inside. The Bruiser fights back, an elbow to the head. A punch into the head. Give Tapu credit. He's firing away at the Bruiser, trying his best, but the Bruiser, well, he's one of a kind, indeed. Tapu slammed backwards into the buckles. The Bruiser, give that arm whip into the corner. Tapu being bounced around that ring rather handily at this point by Dick the Bruiser. Tapu goes down. The Bruiser lines it up and up on the ropes. So Dick the Bruiser. The crowd cheers and yells as the Bruiser mounts the rope, walks down that second rope, and then scores with an atomic drop on Tapu. Out of one, two, and three. Dick the Bruiser with the atomic drop. Runs roughshod over Tapu. Tapu did his best. He hung in there as best he could. Oh, the Bruiser's not finished yet, and Tapu is nearly deposited into the front row of spectators. And now the Bruiser says to one of the ladies, hey, I like your look. And there's the Bruiser with that famous atomic drop, slamming his weight into a mid section of Tapu. Tapu down. The Bruiser covering him, forcing the shoulders down. The referee making the count, and Dick the Bruiser, the Missouri State champion, has another victory. Here is Mickey Garagiola.
In 4 minutes and 55 seconds, the atomic drop, the winner, Missouri State champion, Dick the Bruiser.
A diamond is the world's hardest substance, but 2 years later, you still can't cook on it. Introducing Armor Coat 2. It's brand new, with bigger and better pieces like this huge nonstick three-quart saucepan. Watch. These are burnt baked beans. A disaster. But with Armor Coat 2, they come out this quick. This incredible saucepan comes with a cover that also fits our amazing cook and serve pan. It too has the famous Armor Coat surface. Even burnt pudding won't stick to it. And look, the pans go together to form a double boiler. It's great for sauces, melting chocolate, and steaming vegetables. Next, we'll baby you with the world's greatest baby food warmer and nonstick egg poacher. How much would you pay for a 7-in-1 combination like this? Don't answer until you see this extra deep covered fryer. It holds more chicken than a hen house. Does scrambled egg mess leave you shell-shocked? How's that for nonstick? And you can even make pancakes without a spatula. But wait, there's still more to Armor Coat 2, because this cover fits a gigantic 5-quart Dutch oven. Cook a huge pot roast. Make mounds of spaghetti, a gallon of chili, and heaps of boiled potatoes. And if they burn, don't worry. This is Armor Coat 2. Now how much would you pay? Well, hold on to your seat, because you also get a complete Armor Coat bakeware set at no extra cost. Muffins flip out like this. Cakes come out like this. And bread pops out like this. It's also great for meatloaf. You get all this fabulous Armor Coat cookware and bakeware for the incredible low price of only $34.99. We challenge you to find a better value anywhere.
COD and credit card customers call toll-free 1-800-453-4000 or send $34.99 to Cook and Bake, KPLR, St. Louis, Missouri, 63108. You get the amazing 7-in-1 combination, the extra deep fryer, the huge Dutch oven, and the complete bakeware set. Limit 2 per customer. Order now.
The Von Erichs, Jack Briscoe, the Funks, they all have something in common. As young wrestlers, they made their mark. They made their reputations right here in St. Louis. And here's a young man, Mark Romero, who's going to be in action later today. Mark, a lot of people think you're on the verge of that type of success. It must be a good feeling.
You know, Larry, I come to this business when I was a little boy. I was raised in the ring. We had a ring in our backyard, and I was out there for 8 hours going back and forth in that ring. And now I'm climbing that ladder, and I am going to the top, Larry. I am going to the top. I'm working my way up there right now. I've had many, many difficult opponents. I've had Hernandez. I've had Ric Flair. I've had anybody. Dick the Bruiser, it might be your turn next. Not you.
And of course, it's worth mentioning, you mentioned the ring in your backyard. Well, that was because your father, Ricky, was really something of an idol throughout the Southwest. How much has your father's input helped you?
You know, my father helped me a lot. He showed me everything I knew. You know, I watched my dad for many years. When I was a young kid, I watched and stood back and studied everything he did. And now I have come to St. Louis to do my thing for the people in St. Louis. These people in St. Louis are the number one fans in the Missouri area. And Larry, I can't tell you anymore.
Well, of course, you have a big tag team match coming up, and you have a good partner. It's going to be you and Rufus R. Jones against Kim Duck and Hercules Hernandez. How much does it mean to have a partner like Rufus? He's been through the wars before.
Rufus is the number one black wrestler in the world today, and he is one of the best in the world today. And it's going to be my pleasure to have him in my corner.
You know you can rely on him if the going gets tough.
That's true, Mark. Larry, I'm going to rely on him, and he's going to take care of me.
And, of course, you have your eye on that main event, too, like everybody else in the wrestling business, the Bruiser and Race. How do you see it? Any predictions, the Bruiser and Race, 2 out of 3 falls?
It's going to be a tough one. I'm going to be rooting for the Dick the Bruiser. I'm going to be watching their matches. I'm going to be studying what they do.
And maybe picking up something from that. Mark, thanks very much. Mark Romero has been our guest, and we'll be back with more right after this.
Source of news and information, what would you want it to be? Think about that for a moment. Only one source of news and information. What would you want it to be? If you say Time magazine, you're by no means alone. You're among more than 29 million people all over the world who read Time to discover how the events of the nation and the world affect them. Not just one week, but every week. Time's lively writing and pictures get to the heart of show business. Sports, medicine, politics, space, and religion. More than 30 regular departments that bring you information, ideas, and entertainment. And now, Time makes an offer so big it can't be ignored. 26 weeks of Time for almost half off the cover price, payable in three easy installments for $6.77. So call toll-free 1-800-221-6300. Oh, it almost slipped our minds. With your paid subscription, we'll also send you free a special boxed edition of Time's Desk Reference Library, the Webster Dictionary, Roger's Thesaurus, and the Signet Hammond Atlas of the World. Call toll-free 1-800-221-6300 and get Time almost half off the cover price. Our operators are standing by. A half year of Time for three easy installments of $6.77. And the Desk Reference Library, all three books, is free.
The second main event, an Australian tag team match, one fall with a 15-minute time limit. Introducing, from Seoul, Korea, weighing 272 pounds, Kim Duck. From Tampa, Florida, weighing 253 pounds, Hercules Hernandez. From Amarillo, Texas, weighing 272 pounds, Rufus R. Jones. From St. Joseph, Missouri, weighing 246 pounds, Mike George.
Well, Kim Duck has one of those bamboo sticks in the ring. He's a partner of Hercules Hernandez against Rufus R. Jones and Mike George. And this could be a pretty rough and rugged match. Hernandez and Duck, two pretty tough customers, but Rufus R. Jones and Mike George can certainly hold their own against the tough going. Hernandez with that bandana. A lot of people are calling him the Pirate from Tampa. Maybe he's one of the Buccaneers, huh?
Could be.
He looks like one of the Pirates with that short haircut and the beard, and what a tremendous physique Hercules Hernandez has. Kim Duck purifies the ring by tossing salt, a tradition among many of the Oriental wrestlers. Remember Taro Miyake, Kenji Shibuya, Duke Kiyomuka? They did many of the same things. Actually, those sticks that Kim Duck was carrying are kendo sticks. That's indicative of the Japanese martial arts. Kendo sticks. And he took a swat at Mike George right when he got in the ring. Nearly picked off Mickey Garagiola's head. And Mickey says, "I'm going home, back to St. John's. If you're on the fourth floor, go see me again." Mike George, with a couple of forearms, smashed the Kim Duck's head. Side headlock by Kim Duck, but not for long. Mike George countered the head scissors, but Duck got away. Duck and George, cautious, come to grips. Side headlock, nice move by Kim Duck. Good move. Pulls George back into the corner to tag Hercules Hernandez, and then hangs on to George long enough for Hernandez to do some damage to Mike George. Hernandez in with a hammerlock on Mike. Down goes George. I think the tights might have been pulled there. Like Mark Romero, Hercules Hernandez is a man who could certainly make his mark in professional wrestling. He has the power. He has the raw skills and the abilities. Tag is made to Kim Duck. Hernandez hangs on to George. Kim Duck with a chop into the ribcage. A chop to the throat by Kim Duck. Double wrist lock by Kim. George can stand a tag. He reaches inside, though he might be able to counter, and he does reverse the hold and into a hammerlock. Mike George grabs Kim Duck and throws Kim Duck into the top turnbuckle. Tag made to the popular Rufus R. Jones. Rufus goes to work on the arm of Kim Duck. of course, is a master of the martial arts, all forms. So he is a dangerous man from almost any position. You can bet that Rufus R. Jones and Mike George know this well. It's a good chance for Rufus to do some first-hand scouting as he'll be joining Mark Romero to meet Hernandez and Kim Duck. In an upcoming bout, headbutt to the shoulder by Rufus R. Jones on Kim Duck. And then Rufus locks the arm of Kim. Another match that has a lot of people watching, it will be the showdown between Dusty Rhodes and Big John Studd. Studd hasn't been in St. Louis for a while, but he has been on a rampage up and down the Atlantic coast. And it's certainly an important outing when the American Dream, the former world champion, Dusty Rhodes, takes on Big John Studd. That Studd is a mean one, 6'9", 330 pounds. As you watch Jones and Kim Duck toe-to-toe, and Rufus gets the best of it. Down goes the Korean, Kim Duck. Hernandez started to scoot in from behind on Rufus, but Ed Warren caught him from outside the ring and made him go back to his corner. Tag made to Hernandez. Rufus saw it. He gets out of harm's way, and he's waiting for Hercules Hernandez. How much Rufus has gained over the years. He was not that type of polished wrestler when he first came to the area a few years back, but he's worked hard, gaining the fundamentals. He always had the strength. He certainly always had the determination and the unusual type of style that made it difficult for opponents to square off with him. And now he's added a lot of polish. He's learned a lot of different ways of taking an opponent down to make his guys more effective. Mike George puts Hercules Hernandez down on the mat. Lines up Hernandez with a knee drop into the side.
5 minutes have expired, 10 minutes left.
George leaning into that arm on Hercules Hernandez. Hernandez uses his sheer strength to throw George off. George with a kick to the stomach. Down goes Hernandez. Mike hanging right in there, and he makes the tag with Rufus R. Jones. Hernandez tries to pound on George, but that certainly backfired. And George, before he leaves, scores with a forearm smash. Hernandez down to one knee as Rufus R. Jones turns on that pressure. Hernandez trying to get back to the corner and make a tag with Kim Duck. He manages to do so. Hernandez hung on to Rufus, and that gives Kim Duck an opening that he is more than happy to take advantage of. Kim Duck batters Rufus down to the canvas. Another elbow drop to the neck of Rufus R. Jones. Duck covers Rufus, but the foot is on the ropes. Hernandez tries to shove that foot off, but it's far too late. And that possible pin is broken up. Another elbow drop from Kim Duck on Rufus Jones. Rufus once more drapes that leg over the bottom rope. Rufus pounded on the stomach, and then a tremendous chop. A second chop by Kim Duck to the throat of Rufus R. Jones. Oh, that one stung. And here comes Hernandez. Hercules. And Hercules Hernandez clamps the head of Rufus R. Jones. Hernandez reminds me a lot of Bobby Graham. He had the same nickname, Hercules Graham. And of course, that was because at one time Bobby Graham wore a mask and called himself the Mighty Hercules. If I recall right, it was Johnny Valentine who defeated Bobby Graham and took the mask off, revealing that it was Graham under the mask of the Mighty Hercules. Hernandez has that type of potential, and he might go further even than Graham did. The question of if he can develop the hunger, the ambition, the mean streak that's necessary to make that last big step. Rufus R. Jones in a bit of trouble against the muscular Hercules Hernandez. Hernandez squeezing that head, and he has the arms to do it. Look at the shoulders on that guy. Look at the neck on Hernandez. What a physique. Mike George yelling encouragement to his partner. The crowd beginning to clap and chant and urge on Rufus R. Jones, hoping to give him that little extra shot of adrenaline. Hernandez wearing down Rufus R. Jones. Can either race or the Bruiser wear each other down? It will be a war. Count on it. Rufus showing some signs of life now. He managed to get his head turned inside the grip, and that's the important thing. He got that chin free, and he can move a little bit. Hernandez, though, sledgehammers the back of Rufus. Rufus with a headbutt to the stomach of Hernandez. Oh, that Hernandez can be a bear in there with the power he has. Here comes Kim Duck. A kick from Kim Duck. And Rufus R. Jones once more tries to battle back. He can certainly stand a tag right now. Rufus with a blast to the solar plexus. Mike George yells at Rufus, get over. Kim Duck ties up the head and arm. Rufus uses his size to get over and makes a tag with Mike George. George is fresh and ready to do battle. Here comes Hernandez. George catches him on the run. Kim Duck run into Hernandez. Hernandez tied up in the rope. George sees that. Oh, he looks stuck at Hernandez. Hernandez tries to get out of the way but can't do it. Mike George clearing the deck. Hernandez tied up in those ropes again, but Kim Duck caught George from behind. Duck waiting. Oh, he clotheslines George.
10 minutes left, 5 minutes left.
5 minutes remaining. Kim Duck lifts Mike George, setting him up. Oh, this could be a standing pile driver. Something that Harley Race uses effectively. Oh, the standing pile driver by Kim Duck. Rufus Jones to the rescue. Here comes Hernandez. That could have been curtain. And referee Ed Warren is allowing that tag, rightfully so, because Hernandez did not have the tag rope. Alert work by Ed Warren. It doesn't help Mike George, though, because he's in real trouble after being clotheslined and then that standing pile driver. A weapon that Dick the Bruiser will have to watch out from Harley Race. But the Bruiser knows a thing or two about pile drivers. Knee dropped by Hernandez on Mike George. George shoves Hernandez off. Hey, Hernandez showing us a lot of maneuvers himself. Again, Rufus R. Jones there to help out his partner. I think that time George might have been able to get away, but I'm not so sure after that pile driver from Duck earlier. Oh, George catches Hernandez. A backslide! A backslide by Mike George! Kim Duck there to break up a potential pin. I'm sure Duck can rationalize what he did by saying Rufus R. Jones did the same thing to Kim. Oh, George and Hernandez pounding on each other. Hernandez with George. Body slammed by Hercules. Duck moves by George, catches him coming off backwards, ramming his shoulder into the lower back, the kidney area of Mike George.
3 minutes left, 3 minutes.
A one-arm backbreaker by Kim Duck on Mike George. At the count of two, George gets those shoulders up, but he had to really strain to do that. George is back now, really taking a pounding. Duck grabs the arm, throws George off. He'll pack clothesline. Oh, he throws a judo chop and misses. Drop kick by Mike George. Try to get the Rufus and Duck cuts him off. Again, George rolled and slams his way into the corner. Here comes Rufus. Hernandez in that ring. Duck in the ring. Rufus R. Jones trying to do the effort for his team to give Mike George a breather. The freight train by Troy, he's one top customer. He took those freight train flying tackles, and the headbutt and still survived. Here comes Mike George. Maybe he can finish off the tough Korean Kim Duck. Mike George, the abdominal stretch. Hernandez there to break it up. Here comes Rufus in the ring, and he's after Hernandez. All four men battling it out. Oh, Kim Duck just caught George with a blow that might have been a karate chop. But George manages to clamp on a headlock. Rufus gets a headlock on Hernandez. We're on the middle. Rufus covers Hernandez. That's the wrong man. It's Kim Duck who's the legal man in the ring.
1 minute left. 1 minute.
A Tommy knee drop by Mike George on Kim Duck. Out of two before Kim Duck can get away. Less than a minute remaining. Oh, a pair of chops from Kim Duck to Mike George. Duck has been very impressive. He has a lot of different moves. He's versatile, and he has shown that he is tough. What a drop kick by Kim Duck. George has to put his foot on the bottom of the rope. On the bottom rope, rather, to avoid a possible pin there. There isn't a whole lot of energy left. Reverse neck breaker by Kim Duck. Duck covers George. George gets away. George trying to hang in there, time fast running out. Mike jumps Kim Duck, and he goes for the Boston Crab. If he can turn him and get that leg over the top, he does. The Boston Crab, here comes Hernandez. Here comes Rufus, but Hernandez has already broken. The Boston Crab is applied by Mike George. Hernandez and Rufus really in it. There's the bell, time has expired. And this match is going to end up in a time limit draw. The referee's trying to keep the four apart. It's a draw. Rufus or Jones and Mike George against Hercules Hernandez and Kim Duck. Mickey Garagiola carefully making his way into the ring, and I can't blame him a bit. Let's hear from Mick.
With time running out, referee declares this match a draw.
The Missouri State Crown is up for grabs in one of the features on the wrestling slate at Air Conditioning.
Weighing 235 pounds, Mark Romero. From Danville, Illinois, weighing 235 pounds, Jack Kruger.
Mark Romero takes on Jack Kruger. Most falls to curfew. Whichever man has the most falls when time expires will be the winner. Kruger, a rough-and-tumble customer. Romero knows he can expect a rough one here. Kruger, nice move. Romero kicks Kruger away. Kruger retreats a bit. Mark Romero, lots of speed, lots of speed. That should make Pat O'Connor happy because Pat, of course, the matchmaker from St. Louis Wrestling Club, is also helping coach Mark Romero. If anybody can do it, it's Patrick, of course, a former world champion. He knows the ins and outs, and he can do nothing but help Mark Romero inside that ring. Romero hangs on to the arm. Kruger back to his feet. Romero leaning into the arm. Romero also has a lot of the style, really, of Dewey Robertson, and that he can take to the air so well, like Dewey can. Wrist lock by Mark Romero on Jack Kruger. Don't know how many wrist locks you're going to see when Dick the Bruiser and Harley Race get into it. I think you'll see your share, because don't forget, both those men, while their reputation may have been building some of their toughness, their roughness, obviously, but they know the fundamentals, and a lot of times in an important match, it's those little things that count. The quick cradle, the backslide, the small package, the quick move, because it only takes a count of three to get a victory. Lots of pressure, a lot riding on that match. Best of three falls between Dick the Bruiser, the Missouri State King, and Harley Race. Race will certainly never forget that it was the Bruiser and his pile driver on the cement floor last April that knocked Harley Race out of some important matches. kick to the stomach of Mark Romero. Romero forced down to his knees after that kick to the rib cage. Mark's been trying to use the sleeper hold, working on perfecting that. Of course, that's some of Battle Counter's traits right there. And he's also very adept at the bulldog headlock, a spectacular move. And when you talk bulldog headlock from this area, you have to certainly think back to a gentleman by the name of Cowboy Bob Ellis. Ellis certainly used that well. Romero trying to muscle his way out of this arm lock applied by Jack Kruger. Romero coming up. Mark has the size, and he's such a youngster, only 20 years old. He's going to mature even further in terms of strength and weight, I think. And right now, he's a solid 235, so physically, he's going to get bigger.
5 minutes left. 5 minutes.
5 minutes remain in the curfew, and Ed Warren balls out Jack Kruger for pulling the hair. Kruger and Romero tie up. Kruger goes right to the wrist lock. A knee into the side. Kruger taking advantage of those little openings and doing something that can hurt his opponent. Good thinking on his part. Sort of an inside wrist lock, I guess you would call that, the way he's applying it. Rather unusual method of application, and that's making it that much more difficult for Mark Romero. Romero straightening that arm up. Romero leading into it, and I think Kruger slowly losing his balance and his advantage. Oh, he's in the hair. And before the referee can even tell him to break, he has broken and fiery Mark Romero. Started to go on the warpath there. Kruger backs up all the way into the corner. The wrist lock again by Jack Kruger. Kruger from that position can really put pressure into the shoulder just as well. He might be able to force Romero down to his knees. Romero grabs the beard. The referee stops him. Did I say he's training him, Dick the Bruiser? What? The Bruiser wouldn't be that kind. He'd have already had that beard down by about 2 inches.
He'd have trimmed it real good for him.
Romero gaining the advantage again. Kruger struggling against it.
3 minutes left. 3 minutes.
Kruger cried out, "Watch the hair!" Warren went around, but he got back in time by being active inside that ring. You see Kruger pulling Romero's hair. But Kruger's still on the attack, and Romero's arm a bit the worse for wear at this point. In a hammerlock and all, Romero really riveted, rammed right into that top turnbuckle, the shoulder, bearing the brunt of the blow, and Kruger lining up Romero, dive bombs Romero off the second rope. That's legal. Romero again. Underneath, oh, Kruger going for the top rope, and Kruger turns, Romero's waiting. Oh, Romero has Kruger up high in the air. What a slam by Romero on Kruger. Flying head scissors by Mark Romero. Again, the flying head scissors by Romero. Kruger charges, the back flip by Mark Romero again. Romero has it rolling now after that tremendous slam off the top rope. Romero with the sleeper. The sleeper hole right in the middle of the ring. Kruger trying to get to the rope. Kruger struggling, straining. He's still pretty far away, a good 3 or 4 feet away. And if Romero can lean into him with that sleeper, Kruger slowly going down. Ed Warren checking that arm. And I do believe that Jack Kruger has just about had it. The referee checking the arm. He's out. There's the bell. And Mark Romero has the first fall. And I think it's the only fall. Yes, the only fall that will fit in a curfew. So Mark Romero has a victory. And that sleeper hold, I'm sure, helping to perfect it. Pat O'Connor has turned the tide today for Romero. He had trouble with Kruger. Romero moving in now, lifting Kruger. He's going to wake Kruger up, I believe. Maybe not. He's not too happy about that hair pulling now. Romero once again lifting Kruger, working on the neck and trying to restore a little of the circulation. That pop kind of brings Kruger around a little bit. At least he's conscious. It's groggy. And now we're going to take another look at it. There's that flying head scissors from Mark Romero, bringing Kruger over the top. Kruger staggering to his feet again. He's already taken a tremendous jolt. Don't forget, he charges Romero in reckless fashion. Romero taking advantage of the backflip. Kruger not really too sure where he is in the ring. He has taken some bounces by this point. There goes Kruger hitting the rope. And of course, that's what led to the sleeper hold. And now let's go to Mickey Garagiola.
With time running out, the winner of the only fall and the match in 6 minutes and 42 seconds, Mark Romero.
Friday, August 27th, Dick the Bruiser defends the Missouri state title on the wrestling bill at air-conditioned Kiel Auditorium. The Bruiser risks the state prize against Harley Race. Big John Studd opposes Dusty Rhodes. Tickets go on sale next Friday, August 20th, at the Arcade Building in Kiel. The prices are $7, $6, $5, and $4. Send mail orders now to the St. Louis Wrestling Club, Mezzanine 10 Arcade Building, St. Louis 63101. The date is Friday, August 27th, at Kiel Auditorium.
Thank you, St. Louis, for making us tops in town last year. I'm Harry Slyman.
And I'm Bob Slyman. We're looking forward to another year of being on top.
Because we won't knowingly be undersold on Zenith appliances. That's why more of you came to Slyman Brothers last year. Shop Pat Riley, shop Tipton, shop Sears. But before you buy, come see Slyman Brothers. We don't sacrifice quality or service for low prices. Try us. You'll like us.
Buy Zenith appliances at Slyman's 5 great locations.
I'm Dr. Arthur Hayes, Commissioner of the Food and Drug Administration. The 60 million Americans with high blood pressure need to watch carefully how much sodium they eat. Starting soon, the amount of sodium will be marked on the labels of many jars, cans, and packages in the supermarket. If you have high blood pressure, discuss your diet with your physician and learn how to use the new labels.
The guns have been silent for more than 8 years, but 500,000 heroes are still waiting for their welcome home. If you're a Vietnam veteran who needs a job, medical care, or have other problems you'd like to talk about, the Disabled American Veterans can help. The DAV is not a government agency. We're veterans ourselves, and we understand. Call this toll-free number for a brochure that explains our Vietnam outreach program. There's no charge. Our help is free.
Action certainly was fast and furious today on Wrestling at the Chase. That's something everyone has come to expect. Don't forget that Wrestling at the Chase has been on the air for 23 years. And over that time, virtually every major star in the wrestling world has been there. The youngsters on their way up, the Romeros, the Hernandezes, just like the Von Erichs, the Funks, the Briscoes, and other established stars. They all helped to make Wrestling at the Chase something special. We appreciate your watching this weekend and every weekend. We'll see you next week.
Watching Wrestling at the Chase. This program has been presented in cooperation with the St. Louis Wrestling Club.